Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and today's topic is going to be on manic reparation. Comparing it to normal reparation, manic reparation is designed to avoid painful depressive feelings and take no responsibility for any harm they cause. Sure sounds like the cheater's way out, however do know that people of this type do not get away with it forever. In the long run, the bill does come due. That said, recall that the manic relation to objects is characterized by a triad of feelings, namely control, contempt and triumph. These feelings are directly related to and defensive against depressive feelings of valuing the object, depending on it, fear of loss, and guilt. Again, recall that control is a way to deny dependence. What the abuser says to himself would be, if I can control you then I don't depend on you. That sounds nice in theory, but in practice what this really means is, by controlling you I'm really manipulating you into compelling you to take care of my dependency needs. Next, where there is triumph there is denial of valuing and caring, and this is directly linked with omnipotence. And let me tell you, Narc 2 was all about winning, to the point where I do believe this is where the addiction narcissists are so famous for begins. Triumph is a huge factor in maintaining and sustaining the manic triad. Another thing to keep in mind is that there are two aspects to triumph. 1. The feeling of omnipotence is particularly strong if the attack on the object is motivated by envy, and 2. The feeling of triumph is increased as part of the manic defenses, because it keeps at bay depressive feelings, which would otherwise be aroused, such a pining and longing for the object. Not only does triumph allow the person to bypass uncomfortable feelings, but lets them feel and believe they are omnipotent as well. Third is contempt, and this is direct denial of valuing the object, and acts as a defense against loss and guilt. An object of contempt is not worthy of guilt, and the person uses this attitude, if you will, to justify further attacks on the object. Now let us look at this sense of omnipotence, that is, the quality of having unlimited power. According to Klein, this is what, first and foremost, characterizes mania, and furthermore mania is based on the mechanism of denial. And denial is an effort to alleviate depressive anxieties. I found this particularly interesting, and that is that denial is associated with overactivity. This type of activity, mania, is excessive and does not bear any relation to actual results. For example, I've often talked about Narc 2's hyperactivity. The man could not be still around me. I began to notice, over time, that he was constantly busy, but never really got anything accomplished. I never could quite figure it out, but here it is, mania. His hyperactivity was so problematic, that I would often have to tell him to stop and sit, or go somewhere else, because I couldn't take it anymore. Well, part of that was meant as intentional frustration, he knew it bothered me, and the other part was the mania Melanie Klein talks about as part of the manic position. Furthermore, Klein states that in this state, the source of conflict is that the ego is unwilling and or unable to renounce its good objects, and yet endeavors to escape from the perils of dependence on them, as well as from its bad objects. In other words, let's use Narc 2 as an example again. I'm the good object he absolutely refuses to value and care about, but at the same time will not let me go. He basically wants his cake, that is all the good things that come with being with me, but refuses to put any of the emotional work involved in a loving relationship. And this is so typical of narcissists, they want the recognition and the platitudes, but will not put in the work for actual results. Basically, I want to say I'm married, for the sake of normalcy, but I brutalize my wife. Or, I tell you that I'm the best father around, and love my kids to the ends of the earth, but I shouldn't be expected to pay child support, nor show up to their school functions. Basically, they should be recognized as superior human beings, but shouldn't have to put in work or effort for the accolades. Anyway, the ego's attempt to detach itself from an object without, at the same time renouncing it, seems to be conditioned by an increase in the ego's strength. It succeeds in the compromise by denying the importance of its good objects, and also the dangers with which it is menaced from its bad objects and the id. At the same time, it endeavors ceaselessly to master and control all of its objects, and the evidence of this effort is its hyperactivity. Klein's view on mania is very specific, and is the utilization of the sense of omnipotence for the purpose of controlling and mastering objects. She goes on to say, this is necessary for two reasons. One, in order to deny the dread of them, which is being experienced, and two, so that the mechanism of making reparation to the object may be carried through. By mastering objects, the manic person imagines he or she will prevent them, not only from injuring him or herself, but from being a danger from one another. Such a person using omnipotent control can kill off or destroy good internal objects, but because the person is omnipotent, they can also resurrect them at will. Here, you could say they literally have a god complex. This corresponds to the reparation made to the object. The ego makes this compromise with its relation to real objects. So, this person has retained a defense mechanism from the depressive position, the introjection of good objects, while denying the different forms of anxiety associated with this introjection. Recall that the infant uses the cycle of introjection and projection to integrate the part objects they're born with. Here, the disordered person keeps the introjected, idealized portion of the object, while denying uncomfortable feelings about the object. Essentially, this explains the idealization phase of the narcissist, where they put their object on a pedestal. Not being fully integrated themselves, they are going to relate to part objects, good, bad, and not to a whole object. Even more interesting, is that the ego incorporates the object in a cannibalistic way, what Freud called the feast, but denies it feels any concern for it. Next, concerning the contempt part of the manic triad, it is also based, to some extent, on denial. The person must deny his impulse to make reparation, because he has to deny the cause for the reparation, namely, injury to the object and the consequent sorrow and guilt. Where manic defenses are concerned, particularly triumph, excessive mobilization of manic defenses interferes with the secure internal re-establishment of the good object. In other words, every time the good object is triumphed over, contempt increases, and the feeling of triumph is harder to come by. Here, total destruction of a formerly good object will be realized, just by the mere fact that no more triumph, aka supply, can be extracted. Keep in mind, in order for the manic cycle to be sustained, there is the constant need for renewed attacks on the original object of love and dependence. These attacks set in motion the vicious cycle of manic defenses, but also recall the object is originally attacked in an ambivalent way in the depressive position. When guilt and loss cannot be borne, the manic defenses come into play, and the object is treated with contempt, controlled, and triumphed over. Moreover, reparative activities cannot be carried out, and the ever-renewed attacks increase both the destruction of the object, and its vengeful retaliation, thereby deepening anxieties and making the underlying depressive situation increasingly hopeless and persecutory. You might remember the paranoid schizoid position, where the infant's own fears its own destructive fantasy attacks on the primary object, thus manifesting in felt persecution. In other words, the infant is terrified that the primary object will retaliate in kind. For me, this explains why the narcissist is always on the defensive and forever the eternal victim. Since we know that their relation with reality is shaky, because they live in fantasy land, having never worked through the depressive position as infants, they would see and feel as if any good object would have it out for them. But, of course, the manic defenses will inevitably backfire on them, as there will be a deepening of depressive anxieties. Those never go away unless you work through them, so the depressive position situation will become increasingly hopeless and persecutory. However, sometimes, some concern can be partially preserved, and manic mechanisms can also be used in a reparative way. And this leads into somewhat of a repeat of the previous video, of how manic reparation is utilized. I do think it does bear repeating. So, Manic reparation is a defense in that its aim is to repair the object in such a way, and this is really important, that guilt and loss are never experienced. Remember, the whole point of manic reparation is to escape those initial depressive feelings in the depressive position. An essential feature of manic reparation is that it has to be done without acknowledgement of guilt and therefore with special conditions. And get ready for this, and tell me if you don't see your narcissist here. I know mine fits the bill to a T. Firstly, manic reparation is never done in relation to primary objects, or internal objects, but always in relation to more remote objects. Secondly, the object in relation to which reparation is done must never be experienced as having been damaged by oneself. But, that's always the case, because the narcissist never does anything wrong, right? And thirdly, the object must be felt as inferior, dependent, and deep down, contemptible. There can be no true love or esteem for the object or objects that are being repaired, otherwise this would threaten the return of true depressive feelings. Furthermore, manic reparation can never be completed because, if it were complete, the object fully restored would again become lovable and esteemed, and free from the manic person's omnipotent control and contempt. Fully restored to independence and again endowed with value, the object would be exposed, once more to immediate attack with hatred and contempt. Because of these conditions, the underlying guilt, which manic reparation seeks to alleviate is, in fact, not relieved, and the reparation brings no lasting satisfaction. A general example of this would be the charitable institution, when those in control see themselves as spending charity on unworthy and ungrateful people whom they feel to be essentially bad and dangerous. Also, and this is important, as you haven't noticed by now, this is the narcissistic abuse cycle. Now, as for me, I fit all the criterion of Narc 2's manic reparation, and that is why he had to keep going until I either ran, or he completely destroyed me. And all the damage he caused was simply because he needed to get high on winning. And that triumph is to keep the manic cycle going, all in effort to avoid depressive feelings such as ambivalence and guilt. In short, the infant, and later adult, found a way to bypass uncomfortable feelings in favor of feeling omnipotent, triumphant, and superior. But all is not lost. The narcissist doesn't win in the long run, concerning their mental health. There are major drawbacks to the manic position, even though it does seem they're always getting away with it. In later years, while neurotypicals grow and mature, finally finding true peace and happiness, the narcissist or borderline will not. In fact, the only thing that experience teaches them is to be bitter, and they are doomed to become caricatures of themselves. So you have us normals, having worked through the depressive position, and further coped with life's inevitable losses, who will enjoy good mental health, balanced and integrated. Whereas, the narcissist will always be a slave to their disorder. For the narcissist, having found the way around the depressive position in infancy, have established detrimental fixation points in early development, only to be further reinforced in life by enabling others. They return again and again to that original depressive position, only to have to fight off all those depressive anxieties. With age, this will take an enormous amount of energy, and as their looks fade, and charm wears thin, they will find it more and more difficult to hide their disorder. And, there is always the danger of slipping into psychosis given their tenuous relation to reality, but this will depend on where they are on the spectrum. But not to worry, if they don't go there, there is always the dread of going there they have to live with. I don't know about you, but I do find a little satisfaction in knowing that. Ha. Phew. That was a long one, but manic reparation, also what I'm calling the narcissistic abuse cycle, is a good one to really know if you're going to prevent these people from getting a foothold, and I wanted to give it enough attention. Well, that's it for this week. Please remember to like, subscribe and comment, and if you would like to follow me on Facebook at Narcissist Free Almost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover with a U. As always, all my love and gratitude. And I hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.